Lakes Church, we're glad you guys have all decided to worship with us this morning. Come on in, find a spot, stand with us, and we worship this morning. Thanks, church. We're glad you guys are here this morning. You want to go ahead and turn around and shake the hand of each other? We'll continue to worship here in just a second.
He is mine. Oh, kinds of stuff going on. And this little parable just gets kind of thrown in there. And so sometimes it just gets lost in the shuffle. But it has just as many important features for us to pay attention to as Luke 15 does. But a different set of points than Luke 15. And so we're in Matthew 21, and this is what we typically call during the Passion Week, the week that Jesus is in Jerusalem leading up to his arrest, his crucifixion, and resurrection. And chapter 21 begins with what we call the triumphal entry, right, where Jesus comes into Jerusalem for the last time, and he comes in on what we would call a red carpet. All right, they didn't have red carpet back then. They didn't have paparazzi back then. So what did they have? Well, they had palm leaves and people chanting and putting their cloaks down. And Jesus can't be riding in a limo. They don't have limos yet. So he's riding on a colt, right? And as he's coming into Jerusalem, the people are celebrating and they're calling him and speaking of him as a king. They want Jesus to be elected president. But not president the way we think of president, ruler, monarch, king. And one thing that a king does is he defeats all the enemies of his people. And so when you read in Matthew 21, when they say they want Jesus to deliver them as the Son of David, praise in the highest, it doesn't simply mean forgive us of our sins and come into our hearts so we can go to heaven. No, we want you to come and lower the boom on our enemies that are crushing us, that are oppressing us, and set up your righteousness here on this earth so we can rule with you. Very important. When you're reading the New Testament, do not divorce or separate religion and politics. I know in the South, or in the United States, two things you never talk about, religion and politics. But in the Old and New Testaments, those are synonyms. You can't talk about one without talking about the other. They go together. Now, yes, I know Western history, I know American history, I know what we mean by that. That's another discussion for another day. But I'm talking about when you want to understand the grit of Scripture, you can't do that. When they're asking Jesus to save them, here when he's coming into Jerusalem, they're not asking him simply to take them to heaven when they die. They're asking him to, again, deliver them from their enemies on the earth and take up rule on the earth. That's what they want. Well, it's a pretty big crowd. Jesus is blowing up Twitter. He's blowing up Instagram and Facebook, Snapchat, whatever you use. Everybody's got their phones out taking pictures, doing selfies with Jesus on the colt in the background. Everybody's talking about Jesus. He's getting all kinds of press. And then, once he goes into Jerusalem, he goes to the main place of worship. He goes to the temple. And he's not very nice whenever he goes there, because when he gets to the temple, he basically discovers, kind of like if you were to come into this church and go back into the offices, I was able to see some of the catacombs of your building, some where the offices are. It would be like going into one of the offices and pushing a secret door and it opened up and there's a huge casino back there that you don't know about. And there you can play blackjack or I don't know what else you can play, slot machines, and there's a whole gambling ring here at the Lakes Church you didn't know about. And you find out, hopefully you would not be too happy about that. Well, that's basically what Jesus does when he comes into the temple. He sees all this stuff, everything that's not supposed to be going on in the temple is going on in the temple. And it causes a scene that we can't go, that's another sermon for another day. But the religious leaders are watching this. The scribes, priests, high priest, Pharisees. And they know that if he mounts enough momentum and support, he could be a threat. He could be perceived as a threat to Rome and obviously a threat to their meal ticket. Because if the people stop listening to them and listening to Jesus, then they're going to lose their power. They're going to lose their influence. And so you have all this drama going on in Matthew 21. And obviously it's going to peak once you get into chapter 23, 24, and 25. But in 21, you get down to verse 23, and now we're getting to the point of this story. Kind of have to get the mood so you can really get the impact of this story about two sons. Now Jesus, now another time, now it's probably Tuesday, he enters the temple again. Okay, now, well, the first time he entered the temple, oh, look out. Now he's going to enter the temple again, so what's going to happen? Well, he enters the temple, and the chief priests and the elders, now this is the chief priests and the elders of Jerusalem. All right, these are the final authorities for the Jewish people. The chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching. So he's in one of the court areas of the temple speaking to the masses, and there are always going to be plenty of people. It would be like a religious mall. Imagine a religious mall on a Black Friday. Okay, there's going to be lots of people, right? So you've got captive audiences, all right? So Jesus is teaching, and they come and just interrupt him. They have an OK Corral showdown with Jesus in front of all the people. Now, it's intentional. They want to do this in front of the people because they want to discredit him. And they don't just want to discredit him in a one-on-one talk. No, if they discredit him in one-on-one, there's not going to be any witnesses to behold it. We want to do this in front of all these people that have been chanting his name, singing his praises when he came to Jerusalem initially. We want to embarrass him, discredit him in front of all these people so they'll stop listening to him and recognize that he's a phony. And so they come to him and they ask him a question. And it's a pretty straightforward question. There's only one key thing to keep in mind. They don't care about the answer. I remember when I was a pastor, I knew I had a lot of things to learn. But even when you know you have a lot of things to learn, you're still not always aware of all the things that you need to learn. And I remember when I was the pastor, I would have people come up to me and they would ask my opinion about stuff. I was invisible growing up. Nobody cared about what I thought about something. And now people are coming to Brother Barry. Brother Barry, what do you think about A or B? And initially I would share my opinion. But then it didn't take me very long. It didn't take very long, a few months, for me to realize that a lot of times, not always, but a lot of times when people would in my church would ask me, or outside would ask me what Brother Barry thought about something, they could care less what I thought. They just wanted to know if I were on their side. So then they could go to somebody else and disagree. Well, Brother Barry agrees with me. They didn't care about it. They just wanted to know if I was on their team. Well, here, they don't care about the answer to this question. All they care about is tripping Jesus up. So what's the question? Jesus, by what authority are you doing these things? Teaching, cleaning out the temple, all the stuff he's been doing for the last three years. What authority are you doing all these things? Who gave you this authority? That's a very important question. If Jesus doesn't have legitimate authority, then the people don't need to be listening to him. And this is something the religious leaders made clear in all the Gospels. We have Moses. We have Mo, the lawgiver. He's the one who gives us the authority to do what we do, teach what we teach, say what we say, lead how we lead. Who's your authority? Jesus. Now, verse 24, you have to insert something here, a little parenthesis. When it says verse 24, Jesus answered them, you should put in parentheses, as we did last week in Luke 15, Jesus answered them, knowing their hearts. He knows they have no interest in a genuine answer to his question. I remember one time my son asked me, Dad, this was years ago, if you could have a superpower, what superpower would you want? And my daughter and son, they're cursed because they have a professor as a dad. And so I over-examine questions, you know, and try to be all, just I should have just said fly and just made it simple. But no, I actually thought about it for a minute. And then I answered, to be able to read people's motives. And my son, Dad, come on, what kind of fun is that? And I said, oh, son, I could be the perfect lawyer. There's so many things that I could do so well if I could always discern a person's motive and why they ask the things they ask. Read people's minds. Not control their minds, just read them. Ooh, that may be too much power for one person. But Jesus, he knows. I mean, imagine if you walked in this morning with a little TV screen on your head that projected your thoughts. and you can't stop it from projecting it. That's how you are before the Lord. But it's as big as the screen in the Cowboys Stadium HD. It's bigger than that. So there's nothing you can hide. Jesus knows that. And so Jesus says, okay, you want to ask me a question, by what authority am I doing these things? And I know you could care less. Tell you what, I'll play ball with you. Tell you what, I will ask you a question. Now, if you're a Jesus opponent, look out. I mean, that's not a good thing. You don't want to spar. But Jesus says, let me ask you a question. And if you answer it for me, then I will tell you by what authority I'm doing all these things. So Jesus says, okay, let's make a deal. Jesus, let's make a deal. Give him the mic. Remember that show? Those long old school mic. Let's make a deal. I'll ask you a question, you answer it, and I'll gladly answer your question. Okay, what's the question? Verse 25. It's not a hard question. They asked Jesus an easy question. He's going to ask them an easy question. Did John's baptism, this is John the Baptizer, John the Baptist, or as I call him, Johnny B. Okay, the guy that got his head lopped off by Herod, who baptized Jesus, okay, that John. Did John's baptism or his ministry and his message, okay, baptism, that's what he was known for, so it encapsulates it. Did John's baptism come from heaven or was it of human origin? Did it come from man? Did it come from just mere human authority? In other words, who did John represent, himself or God? Now notice here, they know that even though this is an easy question, it's a potential trap. They know that. So notice what they do. These are the religious elites. Jesus just asked them an Awana level question. What's the lowest Awana level? Anybody know? Cubby. This is a cubby level question. Cubbies can answer this, all right? By what authority did John the Baptist do? And notice what they do. They look at Jesus. They look at each other. They look at Jesus. Time out. They call time out. And they huddle up. Time out. Whistle blow. Or what's the sign for time out? I think it's this, something like that. Time out. On the Pharisees, religious leaders, time out. And they discuss it among themselves. Now, listen to this. If Jesus ever did chuckle, I could imagine at least in his head he's chuckling. Now, they discuss this among themselves. And they try to banter back and forth about their answers. This is better than Fox News or CNN. Listen to this. They discuss it among themselves. Look, if we say from heaven, if we say that John's baptism came from heaven, if we say that out loud, then he's going to say to this, so why didn't we believe him? If you go back and read Matthew and the other Gospels, when the religious leaders come out to John, John is not nice to them. John calls them snakes. Why are you here? I mean, can you imagine if we had an invitation and somebody came down, they wanted to see Christ, and I came, one of the elders came up to me going, why are you down here? Go back to your seat. You don't mean business. You're a joke. That's what John did to these religious leaders because he knew they weren't there to repent. They were there to see the show. They were there to see if too many people were going to follow John, whether he'd be a threat or not. They weren't concerned about John's message. But look, they said, if we say from heaven, then we're going to indict ourselves because we didn't listen to him. So we can't say from heaven. But then somebody else chimes up. But wait. Verse 26. If we say from human origin, well, all these people here listening to Jesus, they think John was represented heaven. They think John's authority was legit. So, everyone considered John to be a prophet. So, if we say to Jesus, yeah, it was from heaven, then everybody's going to look at us and go, well, then why didn't we follow him or listen to him or support him? And if we say that it wasn't from heaven, it's just from man, all these people are going to continue to turn on us because everybody here thinks John was a prophet. So, what do we do? One more, I don't mean any names as an analogy. One of them raised their hand. We punt. What's our answer? They come back, time in, whistle blows, they come up to the line, they look at Jesus, and their answer is, verse 27, the religious elites, their answer is, we don't know. Religious elites. Really? We don't know. I can imagine Jesus looking at them and saying that, really? You don't know. By what authority John did the things he did? And so Jesus says, all right, fine. Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. But Jesus is not done. Jesus is basically going to answer their question for them. He's actually going to answer both. He's going to answer their question to him, and he's going to answer the question about John. But he knows that he's not going to be able to do it by actual discourse, because they're disingenuous. They have no interest in having a dialogue. So how can he disarm them? As we've mentioned, he tells a story. That's what the story does. It causes you to let your guard down, and the moment you do, you have a great big fist right in the nose. He gets you. So, this is where we get to the story. Verse 28, I tell you what. Verse 28, what do you think? Let me try to ask you a question that's even easier than the one about John. Whatever is pre-cubby, whatever pre-cubby would be, let's try that level and see if you can answer that. You didn't know 2 times 2. Let me try 2 plus 2. See if we can do that. Maybe you'll get that one right. All right. So what do you think? A man, here we go, here's a man had 2 sons. Oh, we've heard that before, right? A man had 2 sons, and he went to the first one, and he said, my son, go work in the vineyard today. Now, this is a very common thing. I won't actually ask this of you, but I seriously doubt that most of you in here do for a living what your parents did for a living. Now, there might be some of you. If you do, it's probably a family business or a family trade that you've taken from. But that's just not our culture much anymore. There's just not a whole lot of that. I mean, I am pitiful. My father apparently was a mechanic, and my father-in-law is a mechanic. I am mechanically challenged. I mean, I can change a car battery. I used to be able to change the oil when I was a teenager, but it's too much trouble to do all that now. I mean, there are a few things, but not much. Not much that I did not take. I did not pick up those skills from my genes or my DNA. But in Jesus' day, most sons did whatever their dads did. Most of the time. So when it says go work in the vineyard, it's not equivalent to just saying, son, go mow the grass. It's son, go help take care of the family business. I mean, the vineyard could be something owned by the granddad, the great-granddad. It could be something passed on for generations. So to go take care of the vineyard is a much bigger deal than just going, quote-unquote, to do your chores. Okay, there's some family honor in this request. Son, go work in the vineyard today. And notice it doesn't say, my son, would you please go work in the vineyard today? It's go do it. And verse 29, you get a shock. I mean, this would be a jolt in Jesus' day. The son answered, I don't want to. Now again, we read that and think, all of us as teenagers, take the trash out. I don't want to. Wash the dishes. I don't want to. But again, it's more than that. Again, it's not just saying, I don't want to do that. It's an affront to the family and a huge dishonor to the father to say that. You just didn't do that. That's what made this last week's story show jolting. Dad, liquidate my inheritance so I can have it now before you die. I mean, you just don't do that. So here, that is a big deal for this dad to tell the son to go do this and the son to say no. But notice this. But later, now later that day, later in an hour, later that week, again, it's a story. You don't have to worry about all the timetable questions, okay? It's just a story. But sometime later, that son who told his dad no, sometime later, he changed his mind and he went. Eventually, that son initially didn't do the right thing, But he changed his mind, and he went into the vineyard and did what his dad told him to do. But it didn't start that way. Okay? Then the man went to the other son, maybe younger, who knows? Maybe the first one was older, the second one was younger. We're not told. But he went to the other son, and he said the exact same thing. Son, go work in the vineyard. Maybe another part of the vineyard. Maybe in the same part of the vineyard where his brother was. We don't know. But go work in the vineyard. And then notice here in your translations, I will serve. Not only does this son say yes, he gives a most an honorable, reverent, respectful response. Remember the story of Samuel in the Old Testament, whenever he was a little boy and he's in the temple and he thinks he hears the Lord calling, and then finally when he realizes it is, yes, Lord, here I am. Yes, Lord, right? Or Isaiah chapter 6, the great vision where King Uzziah is dead and the Lord's making the point that he's still on his throne even if the king of Israel is dead, not on the human throne. And he has a vision of the Lord, and the Lord has a message to be sent to the people who will go for us. And Isaiah, here am I, Lord, send me. So, similar language here. This son, not just, sure, Dad, not even, Dad, okay, fine. No bad attitude, no back talk, no sass. Absolutely, Father. It is an honor to be a part of this family. I'm already there. Whatever words you want to put in there as the absolute pinnacle response to his dad, this son does that. But there's one catch. He answered, but he didn't go. And that's the end of the story for that son. So one son gave a terrible answer, repented, and did what his father said to do. The other one gave the absolute best answer you could possibly expect and didn't do a doggone thing about it. He lied. But it was a pretty lie. It was a respectful lie. It was a colorful lie. And then verse 31, okay, here's the pre-cubby question. You religious leaders, which of the two sons did his father's will? Can you answer that one? You have to call a timeout for that and negotiate the answer to that? Can you answer that one? And they said, the first. And I could even imagine saying the first, there might be a little reluctance because he's not telling this story just to simply get out. I mean, there's got to be a catch. But the answer, because at this point, if they don't answer that, they already look foolish. If they don't answer that, then they might as well just take their ball and go home in front of the public. So yeah, the first. And now Jesus, finally, you answered one question. Now let me answer yours and my own about John. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, anytime you see that truly or old, you know, Old King James, verily, verily, or truly, truly, the word translated there is the word we use in English, amen. I've heard it a few times here at this church, but when I was the church I was raised in growing up, amening the preacher was a big deal. Doesn't matter to me. I mean, I can remember one preacher, the more you amen me, the shorter I preach. And then everybody would say amen out loud. Amening was, you know, you're affirming something that you agree with in the sermon. Jesus here, he is confirming, he's amening himself. Regardless of whether anybody agrees with what he's about to say, if he's going to say it, that's all that matters. So it's like if you're on a ship and you hear the intercom come over and it's just some worker, there will be a buffet dinner at 7 o'clock in room, you may pay attention to it, you may blow it off. But if the speaker comes on your ship and you hear, this is the captain speaking, you're going to pay attention for a moment just to make sure that it's nothing. Why? Because it's the captain. So when Jesus says, truly I say to you, in other words, you can bank on this. Heaven banks on this. Okay? Truly I say to you. Now remember the parallel here from last week with the prodigal son. If you remember, the prodigal son started off with an ordeal where Jesus had people coming to him to listen to him, and that upset the religious leaders. The tax collectors and the sinners were coming to Jesus last week. Notice here, Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you." The prostitutes and the tax collectors were two classes of people that everybody agreed were sinners. Even the tax collectors and prostitutes knew they were sinners. And Jesus says, when it comes to the kingdom of heaven, when it comes to the kingdom of righteousness, the kingdom of God, and you look at the line of people that are waiting to go into that kingdom, they are first in line. But you look at their lives, they did not say yes to God first. They told God no a lot in their lives. That's why they are what they are. They're known for saying no. But now they're changing their mind and repenting. And they're coming into the kingdom. They're like that first son. They said no a lot. And they said no in very ugly ways. But then later, they're repenting. And they're coming into the kingdom. And notice he says, before you. And then here we go to John, verse 32. For John came to you, here I'll answer your cubby question for you, in the way of righteousness. His authority was heaven. And you didn't believe him. Tax collectors and prostitutes did. But you, when you saw it, didn't even change your minds then and believe him. These religious leaders, they had all the right vernacular. They had all the right vocabulary. They had all the right answers for the people. They had all the right clothing. They had all the right rituals. They had all the right look. But they could care less about being faithful with everything they told the people to be faithful about. They could care less about loving God with all their heart, soul, and mind. They could care less about loving their neighbor as themselves. They could care less about God's righteousness. All they cared about was promoting their own agendas, their own selfish ways to live in their luxury, to live the way they wanted to live, but to put on a facade so everybody thought they were spiritual. And Jesus said, "You're just that second son. You have right answers, good words. But then whenever you leave, you don't go do what you tell people to do. You don't do it." And so if you continue down that path, there's another Six Flags line of people that are going to the kingdom of darkness. And that's where you're headed. There are plenty of people, plenty of people, maybe even some here this morning, plenty of people that people can have perfect religious lingo. They can know all the right choruses, praises, Sunday school lessons. They may even give money, and they could care less about living for God. What do you do that makes you different than someone this morning who doesn't live for God? What do you do that an unbeliever can't do? Well, I'm at church. Trust me, unbelievers are at church. I can preach. Trust me, there are unbelievers who preach. I give money. Unbelievers can give money. What do you do that an unbeliever can't do? If you cannot answer that, I admonish you to be like this first son. The first son repented. And here's the thing. The second son, he can repent too. In the story, he doesn't. But don't try to pull a hustle on God. Don't do that. You can hustle other people. We can fool each other. We can. We can fool each other for a while. We can fool each other. We can put on an act. We can do that. But folks, you cannot put a hustle on God. You can't fool him. Life will either reveal our character or expose the lack of it. One of the two. These religious leaders were the ones who were supposed to be the stewards of Israel for the coming of Messiah. And the only one who did it was John, and he was rejected. And Jesus shows up to these religious leaders, and they're questioning his authority. They're questioning by what authority he's doing what he's doing. And Jesus looks at them and says, the one guy who represented heaven, the one guy, John, who represented heaven, you ignored. The real question is, by what authority were the religious leaders doing what they were doing? That's the real question. That's the ugly truth. See, that's the thing. Today, especially last year with the election, we heard the word narrative over and over. They're spinning this narrative like this, and this media outlet's spinning this narrative like this, and this is spinning this, creating this reality of how we think things really are. Well, here's the thing, folks. The Lord is an expert at tearing down our stories of what we want to pitch for the world to think about us. He is an expert at that. And the Lakes Church needs to be a body of people who don't just have all the right words. It's one thing for me to shake your hand during the greeting time, hey brother, hey sister in the Lord, love you, and then come back here and be upset or mad at somebody and unforgiving and bitter because something that's gone on. Doesn't matter all the words if it's not coupled with action. It has to be coupled with action. In Luke, there's a phrase that haunts me every day where Jesus says, you call me Lord, then why don't you do what I say? Lord doesn't simply mean Savior. It means King. And when a king tells you to do something as a citizen, we do it. Saying Lord is important, but it's not sufficient. It has to be coupled with love and action. Action. How we care for each other. How we forgive one another. How we express love for those who need the gospel. How we worship together. How we learn together. How we grow together. All those things have to be changing the inside. And then out of that do come right words. It's not that words aren't important, but words by themselves are cheap. Very cheap. But when words coupled with action, that's what the world can't ignore. The world can reject it, but it can't ignore it. And so if Sachse is going to be confronted with the gospel through this church, we must be a community of people who, even if we say no, we repent and then get in the vineyard and start working. And if you said yes, I'll work, and you haven't, repent and get in the vineyard and start working. That's the thing. The story isn't you can't repent. Of course you can. And you can get in the vineyard and go to work. But the question is, will we? Let's pray. Father, Lord, thank you so much for your grace and your mercy that you extend to us every day. Lord, you know how weak we are, how frail we are, how inconsistent we can be. And Lord, if we're honest, we could actually confess that sometimes we're both of those sons. Sometimes we just say no and repent later, and sometimes we say yes and don't do what we said we would do. We're guilty of both. And Lord, we pray that by your Spirit you would enable us to always come back full circle to you, to be reconciled, and go do what you've told us to do. Lord, I pray that each heart here today would leave here with a right relationship with you. Lord, someone here today who's never called you Lord, or maybe wants people to think they have, but they haven't. I pray that you'd work in their heart today. Lord, let us all leave here as your children who say yes, and then by your Spirit, obey. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As our musicians here are about to lead us, just want to encourage you at the end of our service, we will have our leaders, our elders here at the church to minister to anybody who may want to have someone pray with them. Maybe you want to learn more about how to know Christ. Maybe learn how to become a part of this church family. Or maybe just have someone hurt with you and pray with you over a need you may have. whatever it may be, we're going to have Brother Allen and Brother George here at the front, and we'll have Brother Malcolm and Brother Joel at the back after the service is over for anyone who would just need someone to minister to you. Our invitation, regardless of whether there's music going, is always open as we sing.
Thank you, brother. This morning I saw a few new faces. Welcome to worship with us. We have some extra people. Joe, it's good to see you here. We've got extra people in the band. I get the opportunity occasionally to say something funny, so it's going to be a change. But I get the opportunity once a month, as a lot of men do, to get to sit in the back. It's part of the security duty. You know, we're here to keep you safe, so you're safe because of me today. So, but I get to sit in the back, and part of sitting in the back is you get to see people as they come in. You get to see Bill walk around and act like he's blind because it's so dark back there. You can drop an iPad on your wife's toe, and only the people in the back can turn around and actually see that I'm the one that did it. But the great thing about sitting in the back, it gives you a different perspective. For the last 4 or so years, Angie and I have sat up front. But sitting in the back, sometimes you get to see other people worship. The Revelation song, I think that's the song that Cole had sang before. Miss Gilly has sang it before. But it's great to see people worshiping. I came from a real strict church as a kid that you stood still and you sang and you didn't do anything. But it was like, I hope this doesn't sound like, it was like a rock concert. People were excited for Jesus during that last song, and you could just see it through shadows of people just encouraged by what y'all are doing. How we're worshiping. So I want you to know it doesn't go unnoticed. I come up here and joke with you every night. I love you to death. You're doing a great job. So, if you will, in the seat back in front of you, there is a card. Members and visitors alike would like to know you were here. On the back, you can put prayer requests as well. In the bulletins that Bill and Carolyn hand out, there was some of these had it in there. If it did not, they're in the back for you to pick up. It came from Amy, and it's just to let you know about what's going on in the children's ministry down there. So there's some important news about the different camp that they're going to this year, a bake sale, potato bar, what's that?
Easter program.
I knew I was missing something. I always get told these, and Angie will circle them, and I never read them, so I don't even know why I bring them up here. I try my best. But if you didn't get this, please get it, because there's some important information that you need to know. So, I know Brother Everett told us that next week we will be partaking in the Lord's Supper, so I look forward to that. As our ushers come down front, let's prepare to give our offering. Dear Lord, thank you again for the awesome opportunity to come worship you. Thank you for what you've given us in the matter of a pastor that you've led him to us for right now to help lead us in this transition time. Help us to continue to be good Christians and to bring forth your word to others in this community, and help us do it in a manner that's pleasing unto you, and help us give back a portion that you richly bless us with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand to worship.